by me. I'm just saving the world.
Did you know that saving the world from climate change is apparently as easy as switching some of our fire departments to fluorescent light bulbs? Well, here is a grant for $980,000 for the empowerment and development of women currently working or seeking work in the clean energy sector. Nothing wrong with that either. But is that really our most pressing issue at the moment, or are we just pretending like we're doing something? Because if you're an inventor with a possible solution to climate change trying to apply for one of these grants, they first send out an FBI agent to you.
The adventure looks real.
And once he finds out it's real, they will come with a warrant, confiscate all your equipment, prototypes, and data collections. Now, why would that be, I wonder? Does the US government not want cheap renewable energy? Here's a list of the largest companies by revenue. Do you see now why Wayne Travis, an American inventor, had to sign a contract with a German company to get his machines manufactured? So let's take a look at his disruptive invention and the design that is now used to build the first commercial units. In this video, we went over the fundamentals to understand how Wayne's energy machine works and why it is not an over-unity device. If you haven't watched it yet, I urge you to watch it first and then come back to this one. But before we dive into the final design of his commercial machine, there's one more component that I would like to demonstrate. Most of you are probably familiar with something called the mechanical advantage, where you can multiply force by using pulleys. But you might not know that you can do something very similar with pressure. For this experiment, I first tried a pressure gauge, but the pressure was so low that I had to build my own parameter. As you know, pressure head or hydrostatic head is the height of a liquid column that corresponds to the pressure exerted by the column on the base of the container. If you connect liquid columns, as you can see in my simulation with the plastic tube, the pressure of the first column gets transferred over the air to the second column. The total pressure is all pressures added together. As with the pulley, you can multiply pressure, but you lose distance. Wayne has used this method by adding several layers to his pods, and as a result he gets more force and is able to lift a much higher weight. You see here one of his earlier prototypes and the way they measured all the different pressures in the system. After testing it in the lab, they built a larger system to see how much power it can produce. In and out, up and down. How can you build something that is up while it's down, and down while it's up? We don't want a system where you put in the work and then you have to wait for the next step. I mean, that would be like having only one shovel while everybody else is waiting. With the teeter-totter principle, one side is always working while the other side is getting set up or prepared. One way to make sure a system is balanced and some part is always producing is with a crankshaft design. What you see are some earlier prototypes where the goal was only to prove the functionality and to see if you can produce more energy than what the system needs to function. From there, Wayne went through the process of subtraction. Subtraction means removing anything that does not add value, that is too complex or requires too much maintenance. A perfect example of subtraction that has every other car manufacturer scratching their heads and other body parts is how Tesla made their battery part of the body frame and underbody with its new structural battery pack. So how Wayne ended up with his commercial design involved removing, streamlining and simplifying things. And the crankshaft is back in the chocolate factory. Connecting the two cylinders in the bottom like this acts just like a teeter-totter. Now that Travis effect that you know from the last video makes an appearance, Wayne calls them risers. One is added to each side. An accumulator is used to balance the output side. An accumulator is essentially a way to store hydraulic pressure, kind of like a rechargeable battery. A bladder filled with nitrogen gas and its compressible and decompressible nature is used for that. And here is how Wayne's machine works.
So back on here, so here we have our levels
equal. But if you were to change them, like this one would become lower, the air would automatically transfer to the other side, and they would still be level, and just your airline would be in the hose. The hose would be full of air.
Transfers over, one side becomes buoyant while the other side sinks. What you see here is a prototype that is closest to the final design. The system here is running in a closed loop and producing power. When the air transfers over after the valve is opened, the riser that becomes buoyant pushes the power stroke. That energy is captured and converted using a hydraulic motor connected to a generator. Once the power stroke finished and the air valve is locked, the teeter-totter hydraulic cylinders at the bottom will pull down the riser. These cylinders are only about half the size of the power stroke cylinders on the top. To prevent the cylinders in the bottom to get pushed down during the power stroking, they get hydraulically locked. The air valve opens and the cycle repeats. Everything is controlled and monitored by a microcontroller.
A system that is economically sized is not really meant for a single household. I'll show you what I mean by that in a second. There is already ideas and concepts floating around how to install this into a shipping container.
As you see from my little experiment, a certain surface area is required to lift heavy weights. Otherwise, it doesn't matter how much air you pump into it. This means the larger the riser parts, the more energy you can produce. But the surface area to output ratio is non-linear, which means the larger the unit, the more economical and the faster the return of investment. And the reason for that is because if you double the surface area, the lifting force for the power stroke goes up times 4. You can verify this yourself very easy with any online cylinder size calculator. And this cubic ratio is the reason why a unit below 10 kilowatts is not economical. I don't think my homeowners association would approve of me having a 50 kilowatt unit in the backyard. And then there are my neighbors, they already think I'm a nutcase anyway.
But I think he's building a space rocket out there.
Of course, as with every other system, we have work that we put in, and we have losses due to friction in pipes, mechanical frictions, friction in the cylinders, and so on. But if you watched my previous video on this topic, you know this is not a problem for the Travis effect. So a 50 kilowatt generator actually produces 100 kilowatt, but needs 50 kilowatt internally to operate the system. And this is possible due to the discovery of the Travis effect. Commercial units will be available from 10 to 500 kilowatts. Annual production of a 50 kilowatt unit is over 430 megawatt hours. That's enough to power 20 or more residential homes with it. Wayne's generator causes no pollution, uses off-the-shelf tested components. In comparison to wind and solar, it does not require energy storage because it produces power 24/7. It doesn't require any rare materials, low maintenance, and it's simple to build and operate. Another benefit is that the generator can be subterranean and won't cause any harm to wildlife. Its balanced output is ideal to power crypto mining farms, for hydrogen production. It's also ideal for utility companies and perfect for their peak load shifting because hydraulic generation is instantly responsive. And hopefully we will soon see these generators at every EV charging station. Unfortunately, though, reporting about new energy inventions is not nearly as popular as news about somebody gluing themselves to pictures and streets, all in the name of climate change, of course.
By holding protests at oil refineries, they are literally gluing themselves.
I mean, the fact alone that you made it all the way to the end, a video with no slapping or dancing deserves an applause by itself. This is Heinrich Schmidt. He bought me a coffee and said he liked my generator so much that he copied my design. So I did a little research, and according to this article, he's the inventor of the nitrogen motor and worked together with the father of Formula One drivers Michael and Ralf Schumacher. That's pretty cool, man. In one corner, we have all the protesters blocking traffic, gluing themselves to the road until the hype is over. And in the other, we have guys like Heinrich and Wayne dedicating decades of their lives to find better sustainable energy sources. They pick up their pieces after every failure and setback to continue. Well, I made my decision, who I think makes a bigger impact and is cooler.
Let me know what you think. Thank you for supporting this channel by watching, subscribing, and liking my videos. See you next time.